The following is a production of the University of Minnesota.
We're celebrating this year the 100th anniversary of the establishment of the Faculty Senate at the University of Minnesota. So that was 1912. Why 1912?
Well, there are many things.
Can you put that in a historical context as to what else was going on at that time in the state and nationally?
Right. Nationally and in the state, this was in the midst of what we call the Progressive Era. The Progressive Era was characterized by a growing sense of participation, democracy in our systems, both political, economic, and social systems, and it certainly played a role in education. There was always a belief in higher education that the faculty controlled the curriculum, but that the administration, president, and trustees controlled everything else. And faculty should control the curriculum, teach, and keep their mouths shut. That's the general attitude. Well, that attitude began to change. At the time of the Progressive Era, in faculties around the country, there was a kind of ferment, kind of movement to get a larger share in the say in the university governance and things like that. This was part and parcel of the progressive movement of opening up all our systems. In 1912, Professor Woodrow Wilson and Governor Woodrow Wilson of New Jersey became President of the United States. Woodrow Wilson had gone through himself a whole series of conflicts in Princeton University, where he was both professor and then president. At Princeton University, he wanted to kind of control the graduate school and to make sure that it was not an integral part, that it was an integral part of the university, not off by itself. He also wanted to limit the kind of power of the private clubs to kind of democratize the system. He failed, and failed miserably. The resistance was too great, and that was what convinced him to move out of Princeton to become governor of New Jersey, or to run for the governorship when he was asked to run for governorship, and then went on to the presidency. As president, he kind of personified the idea of opening up the system. And of course, universities began to open up the system by, in fact, creating instruments of joint governance or shared governance. And throughout the United States, and universities all over the country, faculty senates or faculty governing bodies, they were called different things at different places, began to appear. And in Minnesota, it was no different. You know, we were in the midst of the Progressive Era. In fact, Minnesota was such a progressive state then that when the Republican Party split in 1912, in fact, the reason Woodrow Wilson won the presidency is because the Republican Party split, and one segment remained pretty much establishment, and the other, of course, progressive. And it split, and former President Theodore Roosevelt ran as a Progressive Party president, the Bull Moose president, and Minnesota gave him their electoral votes. So Minnesota was in the forefront of this very significant movement, and the University of Minnesota, of course, followed along in this pattern.
What was the political atmosphere like here in Minnesota in 1912?
Well, as I said, in the election of 1912, Minnesota went for Theodore Roosevelt. The Republican Party was divided, and therefore one segment of it went off with Roosevelt. But even the segment of the Republican Party that was the establishment segment also believed in some reforms, political reforms at least, that opened up the system a bit. they weren't quite ready to go to women's suffrage yet, but they were close. They weren't quite ready to eliminate all restrictions on voting rights and access, but they were close. The governors that existed, that ruled or served at that time from Minnesota, were all progressive governors, including the governor that later turned out to be far from being progressive. That was Governor Bernquist. They were all interested in changing the system, making it more responsive, but not so responsive that it allowed riffraff like Democrats and workers and farmers to be involved. That all changed, of course, with the First World War.
Mm-hmm. So that was when the Senate was formed. What were some of the early challenges that the Senate faced in 1912?
Well, it's very hard to say. What the early years of the Senate were probably just kind of rubber stamping what the administration wanted anyway. So far as we know, there was no really major kind of dispute that occurred at the time. The first major challenge that the university had and the Senate had was a challenge that occurred during the First World War, when, at least in Minnesota and other states, there was a kind of growth of what I would call chauvinistic patriotism, of the kind that kind of transformed itself into nativist sentiment and anti-immigrant attitudes. In Minnesota, it went even further. The state legislature, in fact, abdicated itself and its responsibilities and turned over dictatorial power to a public safety commission, a commission which was appointed by the governor, five persons appointed by the governor, and they dominated the state and the state's political activities and social activities throughout the First World War. One of the principles of the Public Safety Commission was to make sure that Minnesota, being a state with many Germans, Swedes, Norwegians, very subversive types, that they remain loyal. And for loyalty oaths, loyalty checks, census of foreign language newspapers, pressure to keep foreign languages from being spoken. And the German community, of course, was very hard hit by this. And, of course, anyone who was somehow critical of American foreign policy and war policy was considered a traitor and had to be removed. Regent Snyder, who was chairman of the Board of Regents at the time, was a member of the Hennepin County Public Safety Commission. In fact, he was chair of the Hennepin County Public Safety Commission. And he discovered that there was a professor of political science, William Schaefer, who was not enthusiastic about the war. In fact, he believed that the war was a wrong thing for us to be in. And there were a few other professors who questioned the justice of the financing of the war, believing that it should be financed by progressive taxation. Regent Snyder and the Board of Regents took action against William Schaefer, having him fired because he was disloyal. Professor West of the History Department was not given such a harsh treatment, but was told he better keep his mouth shut and ink out of his pen. Otherwise, he'd be fired. So, in other words, there was a direct attack on the academic freedom of not only individuals, but the idea of debate and dispute at the university. The Senate did nothing. It did not confront this. Now, it didn't want to confront it for a simple reason. Most faculty members agreed that repression is right. That faculty members who are subversive, destroy the commonality, should be eliminated. So, of course, academic freedom, freedom of expression, the obligation of the university to be an open and free place where debate can take place, this took second place to loyalty in a wartime setting.
Mm-hmm. Do you know whether the issue of academic freedom even in that context even was presented to the Senate on its agenda during that time?
Probably not. Probably not. Academic freedom was being raised as an issue nationally only in certain places. At Columbia University, where a number of faculty members were also thrown out, a group of faculty members led by the great historian Beard protested. John Dewey, great philosopher John Dewey, who was at the Teachers College of Columbia University, decided that in 1916 that it's absolutely essential to have a union for faculty members so that they could bargain collectively and protect academic freedom. So he started the American Federation of Teachers. John Dewey did that. To be sure, American Federation of Teachers became a union of elementary and high school teachers, not of faculty, but it was started by John Dewey to protect academic freedom. The concept of academic freedom was raised by people like that, but it had not yet permeated the culture of the academy.
Once the war was over and we got into the 1920s, the economy got better.
Yes.
We had boom times, and in 1929 we had a crash and the depression of the 30s. How did that play out in faculty Senate deliberations?
Well, it's hard to say how it played out in faculty Senate deliberations, because I think the Senate didn't deal with issues like that. What was happening in the world was outside of the attention span of the Senate. It was dealing specifically with internal matters. And the university was fairly small then, and pretty limited. It had, of course, certain problems about admissions. In the 20s, particularly in the professional schools, but also in other parts of the university, there were rigid quotas on the admission of students who were from, let's say, not quite arrived status. By that I mean new immigrant types. The new immigrant types were Southern and Eastern Europeans, but primarily Jews. Jews who had come out of the high schools in the north side of Minneapolis and west side of St. Paul, who were ambitious to go to school. Apparently, they were getting into the university at a larger proportion than was their proportion in the population. So we got to keep those folks out, or at least limit them to just a certain percentage of the student body. So a quota system was established. An exclusionary quota system was established, which, of course, was accepted by the faculty of the university, because they were not any different from the dominant society. They were part of it, so they wouldn't question it.
Mm-hmm. Things have changed in that regard, I think, yes.